every day in our United States Air Force, and we can't get that done without awesome individuals like you who are engaged in science, technology, engineering, and math, and all the components associated with it, and the people who have a familiarity with STEM who are able to leverage the technology to be able to do things like that. And ultimately, while that's a bit of show, those are our demonstration team with the our Air Force Thunderbirds, the premier fighter crew that we have in the Air Force. We practice like that in order to be able to win our nation's wars. And we have, bar none, the absolute best pilots, the best people serving in the Air Force because they are all high technologists. And I wanted to talk to you a little bit about how we got to where we are. And I've got a couple slides that we'll go through. But first, I wanted to tell you a little bit about me. I know you heard the reference to Korean American. My mother came to the United States. She immigrated from Korea in 1947, and she married my dad, who is of German descent. And when we were growing up, we grew up in central Illinois. We didn't have a lot of money. And so my brother, it was just my brother and me, kind of grew up with the notion that we were going to have to figure out a way to go to college. My brother was groomed from probably when he was a kindergartner, having to sit at the table and eat like a West Point cadet, like this. If you can imagine, sitting at the table and eating. It was a drag. I watched him. I laughed while he had to sit like that. But sure enough, he went off to West Point. And then when we dropped him off at West Point, I ended up seeing a couple of females out there who were in uniform, and my parents said, wow, they actually have women who are going to service academies. That's where you ought to go. And I said, I don't think so. But the next year, I was applying and going to the Air Force Academy. So it was. It turned out to be awesome. When we talk about extreme, that is the extreme college experience. So we have the chapel there, which is kind of the landmark for the Air Force Academy. And then, can you guess who's in the picture there? That's me. And that's my husband, actually, that I met when we were freshmen there. And he flew an airplane, the F-15, very similar to what you saw in those maneuvers that that we were watching on the film. I want to talk about that little image that's over there on the right. That's the eagle and the fledglings. And there are two fledglings and this eagle. This is this 1958, very nice granite-etched stone statue that's on the cadet grounds at the Air Force Academy. And if you can't read what it says, it basically says, man's flight through life is powered by his knowledge. And of course, that came in before women went to the academy, otherwise it would have been people's flight through life. But it's kind of interesting when you look at the fledglings that are there and you got the big eagle. I see some parents here, I know we've got some teachers here. Your mentors are basically that big eagle up there who are mentoring the fledgling eagles, and those are the young kids that are here who are learning their capabilities and figuring out how they'll fly, how far they'll fly. Will they hang with a flock of other birds, or will they fly off on their own and figure out how high they can fly, how far they can fly? When I was growing up, my parents used to tell me, the sky's no limit. That was one of my mother's favorite Korean phrases, and she would say it in her, you know, Korean accent, and sometimes she'd butcher the phrase, the sky's the limit, the sky's no limit. But basically, the sky was no limit. Today, I think I'd say the sky is no limit because you can do anything. The Air Force is the big integrator of air, space, and cyberspace. I was talking to a couple folks earlier about what we do in the cyber realm, the electrons, the warfare that we have that goes on where people are hacking into even your home computers where you get those worms, those viruses. That is big business, and we do that every single day trying to adapt to the newest variant of whatever happens to be out there. And so we kind of have, not that we have hackers, but we have those ethical thwarters who are out there maintaining the cyberspace to ensure that we don't have bad guys interfering into our cyber. Why is that important for the Air Force? Because everything we do in the Air Force, it is integrated based on our cyber capabilities, those electrons that help us to be able to look at where we're going in an airplane, those GPS systems that you have, to even your iPhones, your iPads, everything like that. And then, of course, our ability to use GPS to guide bombs. If somebody takes control of the electrons, our ability to get bombs on target is severely diminished. So that is kind of the integration that we have within the Air Force, and it ties into even space. How many of you guys have ever kind of tried to throw a stone into the air to see how far you can get it? All right. And you've probably figured out that if you throw a stone a certain way, it's going to go a shorter distance, versus if you follow a certain trajectory, it's going to go much higher, and it'll have that arc that you need, maybe if you're trying to hit a certain point after you get its trajectory just the way you want it. Well, we do that every single day. We hurl satellites into the sky, finding the right trajectory, doing the calculations to figure out when and from where, typically it's from the West Coast, that we're able to launch the satellites into the sky to be able to do our nation's business. When I got to the Air Force Academy, it was academics, very engineering-based, and it was a lot of fun. We had parachuting. There's a physics associated with parachuting as far as how you go out. I was explaining to some kids yesterday that when you leave out of an airplane and you're jumping free fall, not some people have a cord established, and they fly out and the cord opens up their parachute. When you go out free fall, you're basically positioning at the edge of the plane. They open up the door. The whoosh of the air is almost taking you out. And you have to position yourself so that when you go out, your arms are out and your legs are out, much similar to that bottom right picture. You have to go out and you establish your fulcrum point is your belly, which is the physics of that is that it allows you to move much slower. You're flying slower as opposed to if you're going out directly. And with every arm movement, your arm will spin you around or you'll stay stable. So the first jump I jumped out when I did the parachuting, and it was fine. It was great. The second jump, I wasn't quite ready. And I got pushed out of the door, and I ended up spinning. The natural thing is to try to grab onto stuff. Well, there's nothing to grab onto. You're grabbing onto air. And then the next thing is, after you can't grab on anything, you swim. Well, you're not swimming and going anywhere. And then all of a sudden, I remembered the training. And that is, you arc, and you establish your pivot point. And all of a sudden, it got nice and quiet as you're sailing through the air, stomach first. And then you can pull your ripcord and be able to get out. So even for simple things, the aerodynamics of going out of an airplane, there's physics involved in that. And there is timing, the math piece of it, as to when is it that you pull your ripcord. Probably want to pull your ripcord and have that parachute open up substantially above the ground so that you have time to anticipate. And then you're moving the toggles, creating your own lift as you're moving in order to be able to land. We also did soloing and gliders. That's a glider airplane that is, there's no engine associated with the glider. Essentially, you get towed by another airplane, and you are let go, the tow releases, and you basically have got to find your own thermals in the air that are swirling around in order for you to be able to get your height, your altitude, in order for you to be able to have enough maneuver room to soar through the skies. And eventually, then, you have to be able to point your nose down and be able to land at a certain point. So all these things at the Air Force Academy, very basic avionics, very basic aviation, very basic engineering, but an opportunity for individuals who are STEM-focused like you to kind of learn more about different things that are outside of the classroom. So in the Air Force, everything kind of started off with the Wright brothers. Y'all familiar with the Wright brothers? Orville and Wilbur Wright, two brothers. They are at the very basic history of aviation. And up here, this is kind of a snapshot of what we do in the Air Force. You see up on the top right, that's what we call an Air Operations Center. This is our cyber center that is located down in San Antonio, Texas. And they are monitoring all kinds of things. From there, they can see network intrusions. From there, they can see things that are going on in Afghanistan, Iraq, and other places. The gentleman that's over there on the right is, this is kind of a funny story. He is a high-tech, what we call a joint terminal attack controller. And here he is in Afghanistan. He has got a mini satellite there where he is trying to establish communication. He's got all this nanotechnology in his backpack. We will airdrop him in to a location so he can establish communication in order to be able to call in. And this is the bad thing that we do. Airstrikes, dropping bombs on the bad people. So he's got that little satellite, and he's trying to establish contact with an airplane in order to be able to give coordinates. And look what he used to get to where his point was, a mule. So this is how we innovate. Sometimes it's innovating on technology, and sometimes you got to use what you got. And it just so happened that this guy needed to get to a certain destination, and the only thing that was available was a mule. And he rode the mule to the destination to establish the communication, made the contact, and we were able to execute the mission. In the bottom right-hand corner is one of our premier jet fighters, the F-22. And if you look, you can see the illuminated cockpit. There are no cockpits like this anywhere in the world, bar none. This is the technology, the advanced technology based upon smart people like you who have allowed us to create this picture of the battle space, which is this common operating picture that integrates the air, space, and cyberspace. And so the pilot who's in there has right in front of him or her the ability to see things that are on the horizon miles out. Enemy jets can detect friendly or foe, can be able to figure out the type of weapon systems other people may be having, can detect any kind of things that are on the ground that might be jeopardizing his or her ability to get the mission done. And it is all integrated in. It takes data points and integrates it into this particular display. So that's a manned aircraft. And on the bottom right is our what we call MQ-9 Reaper, and that is an unmanned aircraft. So can you imagine who's flying those unmanned aircraft? Folks, yeah, sitting there with a terminal, making basically flying that Predator, or that Reaper, I'm sorry, Predator's another one, flying that over miles away. We have people who are in Nevada who fly these things in Afghanistan. That is the connectivity that we have and is all satellite-based. And that Reaper will take pictures, do reconnaissance, they'll take pictures, or it has the ability to shoot missiles. So you, I don't know if that one's equipped with missiles, but you can imagine this unmanned aircraft with a flick of a button, somebody's shooting some missiles. When you look at the Air Force today, it is a continuum of that space, the cyber piece, and the avionics, the air piece, that make it so great. And we've got other services. I know I was able to meet a young man who's heading off to the Naval Academy to their STEM science camp in the summer. And each of the service academies do this. They offer the opportunity. It's free, no obligation, but it gives you an opportunity for you to bone up on your STEM. At the same time, it gives you, for those who are going to eventually apply for college, an opportunity to put something on your resume because it is highly selective. And it exposes you to the various things that we do in each of the military services. Now, how many of you guys use the internet? You know, who invented the internet? The military. That's right. And how did we invent the internet? That, absolutely. Absolutely. So, you guys familiar with GPS? Okay. Who invented GPS? The military. Why? That's right. You guys are smart. So, all these things that, you know, we house, we also then, when it is an idea that's got what we call exportability, when we can give that out to other people, to be able to use, it is a public good. We develop it, we use it, we leverage it to our needs, but if it's got greater good, we put it out into society. And look what has happened, it has revolutionized, the internet has revolutionized society. So sometimes people forget where these good ideas come from. They come from test beds, they come from centers of excellence, of innovation, they come from people who are smart like you. And not everybody who does this happens to be wearing the uniform. A lot of times, we have a lot of civilians who work, and you've heard about this cyber threat. We're growing this big cyber command. And for the most part, those are all going to be civilians. But they are all working to come up with better ideas, using technology, leveraging that technology in order to be able to help protect as the introduction so aptly said, national security, the national security of the United States. And so my plug for the national security of the United States is it's all of our responsibility. When I went to the Air Force Academy, I planned on going for 4 years and paying back my 5 years, and I ended up staying. It'll be coming up on 32 years this summer. And it's been that long because of the incredible talent that we have that serve with us, very close-knit organizations, the power of ideas, and the people that we serve with. And so I just wanted to take this time to give you a little glimpse about the Air Force, the technology that we employ, and let you know a little bit about what I think that hopefully we're contributing to you, keeping you safe every single day. And I want to thank you for this, your support of those proud men and women who serve. Thanks so much.